I would like to welcome everyone to this panel on emerging voices. I think one of the more exciting panels to hear two scholars established in the field, but not so far removed from their doctoral days, and having themselves students that they're mentoring, and two doctoral students. So let's introduce everyone just briefly. Whitney Bauman, everybody knows you're coming from Florida International University, but just to mention Whitney's religion and ecological development of planetary ethics, and also the theology, creation, and environmental ethics. So we shall have them on our bookshelf. Am I right, Whitney, first, then Melanie, then Elias, Munjed, then Elias? So I'll make another introduction as we go on. Please, Whitney.
Okay. Oh, thank you. Well, I have the time card, so I can go as long as I want. All right. So, again, I just echo the thanks that have been going around, but really for such a diverse set of habitats that have now evolved into sorts, all sorts of ecosystems of thinking that Mary Evelyn and John began so long ago. So thank you very much, and thank you for having me, and to the organizers as well for putting on the conference. So 20 years ago, I was sitting in Jay McDaniel's class as a sophomore, and we was on religion, animals, and the earth, and he came back and he said, oh, I just went to this great conference on Christianity and ecology, and he was raving about these people, Mary Evelyn and John, and going on and on about it, all excited as Jay can get, and little did I know that 20 years later, I would be standing here as a emerging expert in the field, right? So wow, what a long way to come. And that inability to imagine then where I would be now is part of why I want to talk to you, or talk about, not to you, but with you, about the importance of critical theory for religion and ecology discussions. So first of all, the whole basis of my riff is that theory matters. So there, that's it, thanks. But theory matters in the sense that it matters to us, it's valuable, but it also matters bodies. It matters bodies in the world, earth bodies, human bodies, animal bodies, plant bodies. We can't stop doing theory, and the university is one of the only habitats that I know where this theory imagination takes place. And I think it's critical to these discussions, because what theory does is it helps these habitats of thought, it helps maintain an ecotonal edge. Everybody's familiar with what the ecotone is, at the edge of an ecosystem. It's actually what allows an ecosystem to be a breathing, living, changing, viable organism. And if an ecotone is closed off, if we try to close off something from its surrounding nature, it putrefies, it dies. And I think this is what theory does. Theory helps to, it keeps us open. It helps our thoughts from becoming deadly, from reifying the world around us. And many people have begun to do these sorts of things. I'm thinking, I'm reminded particularly of David Wood's e-construction, that he develops Derridian's deconstruction into an e-construction. And I think deconstruction there's something very fundamentally ecological about it, right? Because it maintains this sense of openness, forces us to recognize the breathing, embodied nature of thought, which when closed off, reifies life and leads to the putrefaction and death of the planet. And so I think there are several of these types of critical theories that help us do that. Many of you in the room have been engaged in many of them, but what they do is they destabilize our narratives so that new voices and new ways of planetary relating can emerge in the process. Emergent voices can come about and not be stymied. A few of these are new materialisms, object-oriented ontology, affect theory, deconstruction, queer theory, critical race theory, so on and so forth. All sorts of emerging trans theories, disability theories, these so on and so forth. And actually, just to give a small shout out, there are many of you are involved in an AAR project that's bringing together critical theory. It's a five-year project that will result in a publication, but it's bringing together critical theories with eminent ways of thinking in the world religions, so that, number one, critical theorists can be decolonized, so to speak. James Miller is working on a project called Decolonizing Critical Theory in China. But so that critical theory can not always have to go through this recapitulation from Foucault to Derrida, you know, all these Europeans, but that actually you can find these critical theories in most of the world's religions and indigenous ways of thinking. And so that's one of the objects, is to sort of see how these ideas can come together and what sort of fruitful intersections might emerge from them in terms of thinking ecologically about the planet. So I just wanted to put that out there. And also to say that there are many within these critical theories that have acknowledged their sort of taproots into traditions. Terence Deacon, and I would include emergence theory as one of these, but Terence Deacon, not everybody does, and I'm sure, not sure Terence Deacon would, but he acknowledges very much his indebtedness to Taoism. Timothy Morton acknowledges his indebtedness to Buddhism. A lot of the new materialists acknowledge their debt to, well, of course, to Deleuze and Guattari, who also acknowledge their debt to process thought, which is a great source of intersection in these conversations. So I think there are these sort of genealogies that are just important to put forth. Okay, so I'll try not to repeat anything I said in my paper, because I feel like that's what I was supposed to not do. But I do want to give three examples, this is my attempt to ground the theory in some type of example that you can take away so you can not just leave thinking, what the hell was he talking about? One of these is from queer theory, and it's sort of a project I'm working on, and I take from queer theory a lot of very fecund metaphors and ways of thinking about ecological themes. But currently, I'm working on particularly Jasbir Puar's notion of homo nationalism, and really thinking about eco-nationalism. Right? So as a gay white dink, that's dual income, no kids, male who was recently married to a guy, obviously. I mean, if you can't tell, then your gaydars really need some work. But I think a lot about homo nationalism and heteronormativity and my own privilege as a result of being able to be drawn into this sort of nationalistic area of a subject of concern by the nation by virtue of being married and white and these sorts of things and into the capitalist structure. So might there be something we can learn about an eco-nationalism? Might there be a problem with sort of place-based thinking about religion and nature, sort of this idea that we stay in place, right? That can also lead to a sort of parochialism, right? That can also lead to a sense of pride of what's mine and protection, preservation of what's mine. And I mean, there's a whole history of the United States nationalism being tied to its wilderness areas, these sorts of things. So just to say, like, you know, we have to be able to challenge these sacred narratives, and one of those is place and environmental thought. So might we be able to think more about a nomadic environmental ethic, which is something I've tried to discuss in various publications. So I want to be aware of that, and also just to say, in terms of some of the things that have been said about animals today, there's nothing more queer than the natural world and animals, and all you need to do to recognize the spectrum of livability is to really observe the rest of the natural world. So anyways, I'll just leave that little project there, but that's sort of one sort of direction. Another one, and it was something I'm working on right now, is sort of destabilizing this idea of the split between religion and science. I've long been involved in religion and science conversations, and I think that they are always already together. And the project I'm working on right now at the Ernst Haeckel House at the Schiller Universität in Jena, Germany, is on the 19th century scientist Ernst Haeckel and his development of what is a non-reductive understanding of nature. 2 minutes, okay, damn. It's not real unless you have these. So as a non-reductive understanding of nature, and really I'm arguing that this idea of a materialistic foundation for the natural sciences doesn't happen back with Newton, but it's being argued about all the way up into the 20th century, and really it gets solidified in the Second World War and the co-optation of science for the war machine and productive models. And then after the war, it becomes about agriculture and industrializing agriculture, and then technology of communication, transportation, these sorts of things. And it only gets critiqued, right, with Rachel Carson and the rise of people starting to question this reductive model of nature. So this idea of a reductive science that's divorced from value and meaning is really an aberration. And I have 1 minute, so that's good because I have one more point. The other point I'd like to end on is sort of thinking about, new materialisms have really guided me to think about this way, but a new way of thinking about the ecology of meaning-making practices. And I use an example from in my time in Indonesia of a person by the name of Iskandar Wawranuto, and he has founded a environmental pesantren there. He was born to a Jewish mother, a Christian Dutch father. He became a hippie in the 70s, went to Australia, did lots of drugs, came back to Indonesia and to Sumatra and decided to start a commune. And of course, they didn't know anything about nature, so it failed miserably. Then he went to Bali and started an organic agriculture farm. And then he started reading Sufism, and he realized, wait, I'm in Indonesia. I need to convert to Islam and develop an ecological pesantren to convert Muslims into a way of thinking about, if you are going to be Muslim on the planet today, you have to be an environmentalist, right? So to tell the story of this guy's meaning-making practice, you have to tell all these flows. You have to tell Christianity, Judaism, theogens maybe, but all these different flows go into his practice, so it breaks down the isolation of religions from one another and from other sources for meaning making. So those are the types of things that I'm interested in. Thank you.
You all forgive me for pushing, but you can feel the richness of Whitney's thought, especially his new research on Haeckel and that meeting of religion and science. Melanie, I'm pleased to welcome you to the podium. We know you come from Texas Christian University, and that many of us may not know that you have a journalism background. And that's very interesting to see your connection with the several station, television stations especially. But you bring your work, Gifts of Virtue, Alice Walker and Feminist Ethics, to this perspective. And we're interested in your emerging voice, please.
The invitation to come to be with all of you at Harvard is a deep invitation of friendship. I am very grateful to Mary Evelyn Tucker and to John Grimm, and a sweet, sweet friendship rekindling with Frank Clooney and Charlie Hallisey and Janet Geitzo. I have the pleasure of meeting new friends, as we all have over the past few days, and also being able to strengthen the ties and the connections with so many of you who have really begun to shape these kind of new emerging voices. And I will speak a little bit about eco-womanism. I do want to thank so much the work of Sophia, who did an excellent job in opening the conversation of eco-womanism. So I want to thank you very much in terms of shout outs. I also come from a contemplative pedagogies background, and so we will just do a little bit of breathing for 30 seconds. So let me invite you to come to a comfortable position in your chair and to ground yourself just for about 30 seconds. The tone that you'll hear is one of thanks and gratitude, and I'm hopeful that this tone will ground you into your peace and into this moment. Thank you. The gift of being here as a womanist and as an eco-womanist indeed is the gift of friendship. I began the work in 2009 with Charles Hallisey and Janet Geitzo and Carolyn Medine to begin to open wide the conversation between womanist scholars and African, indigenous, and religious scholars, and particularly Buddhist scholars. This particular project, Buddhist Resources for Womanist Reflection, opened up conversation interdisciplinary, interreligious, and comparative religious, in part for many womanists for the first time, coming out of their own Christian orientation, coming out of their own Christian training, coming out of their own Christian faith perspectives, to engage in interreligious dialogue, to think about the fact that because of sexism, sometimes so prevalent in the Christian tradition, and in African-American culture and church culture, that they were looking for a different religious tradition, something that may actually be able to shake some of that sexism off of them. When we think about those Black women, then, we think about the gift and model of Alice Walker. And I'm going to begin, I did begin my paper this way, and I also am going to begin my comments here with some of her work. Alice Walker, of course, is the mother of the term womanist, and eco-womanism really does emerge from that definition, as well as from that field of thought. My first step away from the old white man was trees, then air, then birds, then other people. This opening passage from Alice Walker's The Color Purple describes the religious themes and theological transformation that takes place in the mind of one Black woman, Shug Avery, regarding the connections between her sense of self, divinity, and nature. Forsaking the hierarchical doctrine and logic of domination that served as a conceptual foundation in the religion of her youth, Shug's naming of the earth as sacred and herself as an intimate part of divine existence creates a new path that falls open to intra-religious and fluid spirituality. Embracing a truth that everything is connected and thus signaling the importance of an earth ethic that implies that humans have a responsibility to care for the planet. This dialogue in The Color Purple promotes themes of interconnectedness, quality of life, wholeness, and environmental health. For womanist and eco-womanist scholars, this particular exchange between Shug and Seeley in The Color Purple, an example of eco-literature, right? And we know with, particularly with Katie Cannon's work and womanist thought, that really looking at literature and African-American literature is a major source for thinking theologically and thinking about Black women's voices, this kind of inherent interdisciplinary reality right there in womanist thought. This particular passage is also cited in a fabulous essay by Alice Walker. The only reason you want to go to heaven is that you've been driven out of your mind, off your land, and out of your lover's arms. There's much more to this conversation. Scholars using this literary example as a source use it to glean ethical values that can help shape earth-honoring ethics, earth-honoring faiths, and eco-theologies. That is, like much of Walker's writing, there is a commitment to the engagement of social activism, even within the theory in womanist thought, and that there is a deep connection between the theory and the practice in womanist thought, that there is indeed the presence of the deconstructive through race, class, gender, sexuality analysis, the analysis of environmental injustice, and that one cannot be a full good thinker, that one cannot be a true ethicist unless one is also constructive, the leading towards hope. The link between social justice and environmental justice is also signaled in the work of Dorsetta E. Taylor, an environmental geographer, and Florence Margai, and it does begin to help us to recognize the importance of an environmental justice paradigm. One cannot actually do earth ethics, environmental ethics, without looking at social justice issues. As planetary problems persist, so too do the issues of social injustice, such as limited access to water, disparities of environmental health care. Taylor's work in particular celebrates the field of, celebrated in the field of environmental studies is explicated many, many different ways. And again, this is another example of interdisciplinary conversation. When she really points out the fact that so many communities of color live in toxic spaces. So in Dallas, Texas, throughout South Dallas, where I serve and work in faith communities, we are living in a food desert. As ethicist Willis Jenkins and others have observed, the rise to Anthropocene will result in great shifts in economic power and cultural conflict. Religious pluralism, interreligious and intra-religious perspectives will have to be taken into account when engaging moral systems and developing ethical approaches to climate change. This is one reason why listening to the various religious perspectives about the earth and our connection to it as Black women is so important. Eco-womanism acknowledges religion and diverse religious perspectives from Black women throughout the diaspora and adopts this kind of environmental justice paradigm. But it goes even further, acknowledging the profound source of wisdom and morality that religion, spirituality, and the social protest faith tradition of African American churches has from the Hush Harbor movements all the way to the present time. These particular aspects of eco-womanism become very important when we consider these as sources for thinking about solutions for the time that we're living in now. The links then between these particular women, spirituality, nature, illuminate for us new ways of thinking, new ways of being when we think about the wider conversation on religion and ecology. One of the primary thinkers that has been very important for eco-womanist thought and the development of eco-womanist thought is this cultural critic, bell hooks. And her particular work in Sisters of the Yam becomes a really eye-opening and I think experiential opening space for Black women particularly to recover themselves. She makes the really important argument that even as Black women are recovering themselves from a white supremacist reality, from a white supremacist frame, that they are also recovering the earth. That there is this connection between the self, the individual, and the earth. So in an age of Black Lives Matters, you can imagine how profound this work would be to recover the Black community, to recover the Black self, to recover and to heal trauma, and to also be deeply engaged in the healing the trauma of the earth. An eco-womanist paradigm, then, is in sync with this reality of healing the trauma. When I often present on eco-womanism, I show images of lynchings. And we have come to a place in time where it is so common to see the death, dying bodies of Black men and women. Eco-womanism begins to allow us to really take in these images and to understand that these two are earthlings. That Black lives do matter. What kind of religion and ecology, what kind of discourse, what kind of conversation must we have when we refuse to ignore the social movements screaming all around us? Thank you.
Thank you, Melanie. Very moving. Munjed, I'm so pleased to call you to the podium. Dear friend from many years and continuing to this day, a doctoral student here at Harvard, comparative Christianity and Islam, and your emerging voice. We're so eager to hear you speak.
Thank you, Professor Grimm. I must first off start thanking Professor Grimm and Professor Tucker for taking me on as their student at the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies. They really watered the seeds that I hope are budding. Something I hope something's coming out of it now. I must also share with you, I've been witness to the great efforts behind this conference. Professor Clooney came and spoke with me 2 years ago about this conference, just thinking about it. And this, it's a project that's been in the making for a long time. What I intend to do in this brief moment that I have with you is summarize the thesis statements of those who have come before me and make brief allusion to what's being done now, the emerging questions that follow. The main thesis statement of the field of Islam and ecology, mainly posed by the Islamic philosopher Sayyid Hussein Nasr, is that the environmental crisis is itself rooted in a spiritual crisis. In the human denial of the sacred, Renaissance onwards, nature, the world, and even the human being could only be treated as profane. In limiting the sciences of nature to nature's materiality, nature could only be treated as material. Nature no longer is a she, but now only an it. And thus, all these phenomena, the ecological crisis, come to be. A few weeks ago, I had the pleasure of also of participating in a conference on the environmental humanities here at Harvard. I'll pose one question that I had posed there. Sorry, Professor Dan McCannon, Elias, and others who've been at that conference, feel free to take a 2-minute nap. Why is this happening today? Why is the ecological crisis happening today? Why has it not come about at the hands of people 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, or hundreds of years ago? Why today? What spurs it today? Was it such that people just weren't intelligent enough to produce the instruments that have created the ecological crisis? Is it really just a lack of ability and intelligence? I think the examples that I brought up at the Environmental Humanities Conference were the fact that the Chinese civilization, 9th century China, had created gunpowder and had used it for fireworks. Used it eventually for weaponry too. But I think you would agree that the idea of placing explosives at the tops of mountains, mountaintop removal, would have really just been unfathomable to the 9th century Chinese mind. Imagine going to a Nepalese Buddhist, let's say, and just suggesting the idea of mountaintop removal. The mountain, a symbol of permanence. Lives come and go, wars happen, peace and everything, all sorts of things happen. The mountain always remains the same, unchanged, the symbol of permanence. To destroy or affect the symbol of permanence for something as temporary as what we get from mountaintop removal as the batteries or the microchips in our phones, the minerals that keep alive something for just a few years, 4 years from now, the iPhone will be out of fashion, something else will come about, as just as the BlackBerry went out of fashion, whatever. This idea of destroying a symbol of permanence for the sake of something temporary, so transitory and temporal, would just really be unfathomable to that kind of mind. So they did have a profound abilities. I mean, the other example, the Islamic genius produced the perfect geometry of the Taj Mahal, the Alhambra. This geometry that translates into beautiful melody when put into music. that actually mimics nature profoundly. That intellect, that genius was put towards the production of such beautiful geometry and not the not algorithms for a, you know, like a capitalist stock market. This is not something about capitalism, but you know what I mean. It was much more so that the energy, the genius and all was channeled somewhere else, and rather that the worldview was a different one. Actions are informed by behaviors which are informed by worldviews. And the thesis statement of Islamic ecology has been that the worldview of contemporary humanity is one that lacks a sense of the sacred. And that is what differentiates contemporary humanity from what has preceded it. What this translates into is a consideration of modern science as the queen science, if not the only science, allowing us to study nature for her materiality, physicality, and even her psychology. But that's where the line is drawn. We can no longer understand nature as being more as let's say the Native Americans would, as the Nepalese Buddhists would, as the Southeast Asian Sufi would, like centuries ago. And the thesis statement here has been that there's a need for a sacred science. That modern science is very correct in what it does and does it quite well, but it doesn't provide, it shouldn't be the only voice. The conversation is not a full conversation. And that's where religion can have something to say. It addresses the things beyond the material, for example. So what I'm doing as a budding scholar is I'm trying to ask then, who is nature then? What is nature? Who is nature? Well, many questions have been posed as to like what is relevant, what is beneficial, very important questions. And I feel that they would be profoundly enriched with the question of what is true, in the sense of what is nature in its or her objective reality. Much can be said about this. My attempt is to see nature as all of these wisdom traditions, Christianity and Islam, in my own studies, see nature. I've researched Dionysius the Areopagite for Christianity, Ibn Arabi for Islam. And what I'm finding in my research is that, for example, nature is the theater of theophany, the divine manifestation of a thousand, of infinite names, and a way of knowing divinity through the world. Nature also maintains personhood. I was so fortunate to study Professor Grimm, Native American understandings of personhood in nature. And I find it in the traditions that I study. These are questions that are coming about in my research. What is nature according to these traditions, and how can that view of the cosmos inform our worldview of nature as we try to better understand how we can deal with the ecological crisis and how to better treat nature? Knowing her may help us to better interact with her. Thank you.
Munjed Murad, how proud Professor Nas will be when I tell him we talked today. I'm very pleased, Elias, to call you to the podium. I had only a brief conversation, but how satisfying ahead of time to correct my misperceptions of where your studies, a historian of science, and even more than that, focused on native science. So Elias, your paper is very good, and we're very keen to hear your voice, so please come do so.
Thank you. I hope I can live up to that introduction. I'm really excited to be here, and I thanks so much, Franklin, for inviting me. I'm going to stick mostly to my paper, but I'll try to bridge off of it. So early in my career, when I was first starting to look into indigenous studies and science studies, there was one or two topics that came up most frequently, and the first was this idea of the ecological Indian, and everyone from Shepard Kreck to Bill Cronin to Calvin Martin, who I talk about in my paper, were trying to understand how indigenous practices and knowledges influenced a different land ethic and a different management of land. I frequently became very dissatisfied with these conversations. They're often very, they're written by non-indigenous authors. They are frequently very essentialist. And especially with Calvin Martin, there is this tendency to ignore history, to ignore political circumstances, and focus instead on very simplistic internalist readings of science and religion. And this constant turn away from the political, especially while, again, as a student of indigenous studies and science studies, I frequently was reading Vine DeLore Jr., was very troubling to me. Ultimately, Calvin Martin and Keepers of the Game, who argued essentially that indigenous involvement in the fur trade was a direct result of erosion of indigenous spiritual belief, tried to get out of politics. He concluded his work by looking at the large mammal extinction of the late Pleistocene, and particularly the overkill theory, which is an explicitly political theory. It essentially is based in archaeological explorations that attempt to undermine indigenous claims to indigeneity and to trees' rights, essentially. As was the case with Martin, who never escaped the political, I fear that we are, in our emerging environmental humanities and ecology and religion disciplines, avoiding this question as well to our own detriment. We are underselling our own work, and we are failing to understand the particularities of what is going on in the Anthropocene. This attunement is very much a reflection of my own studies. I work in science studies and queer science studies and post-colonial science studies, but I maintain this apolitical position is shielding the true nature of our work and putting us sort of on the defensive. So to illustrate my point, I'd like to talk a little bit more about the history of traditional ecological knowledge, particularly in the 20th century when it becomes formulated as such. I work on the history of native science. That's what my dissertation is on, which is why I'm choosing to do this. But traditional ecological knowledge is a thoroughly postmodern epistemic category. Indigenous knowledge of the environment is, of course, much, much, much older, but TEK, upon its inauguration, as a unique mode of knowledge production, is an othered category. There's a reason Western ecology is simply called ecology, whereas indigenous ecology is called traditional ecological knowledge. That observation is not a critique or a condition that I think should necessarily change, quite the opposite. The difference is part and parcel of the post-colonial negotiation of hybrid identity. Access to scientific and religious authority is necessary to continue sovereignty, nation building, and social justice projects. And yet, even as subjects who are barred from positions of authority break through institutional barriers, they still find that their claims are uttered as objects of that authority, not as agents. And in this, I'm drawing largely from Homi K. Bhabha, who looks at mimicry and the idea that as colonized subjects attempt to take up colonial signifiers of authority, in this case, science, they still find that they are not white, not quite white, and therefore not authoritative. And it shows the ultimate arbitrary nature of scientific and religious authority in the Western tradition. In other words, the cohesion of science and religion in the indigenous context unravels. While scholars of traditional ecological knowledge, particularly indigenous theorists and practitioners, stress the multiplicity of indigenous knowledges, the broad category of traditional ecological knowledge is a consequence of the kind of strategic essentialism necessary of subaltern subjects. TEK is valuable in so many ways, that's why I study it. But perhaps most importantly, in my opinion, is that it presents a challenge to institutionalized and powerful constructions of disciplinary and intellectual boundaries that are mapped onto reality and reinforce colonial and post-colonial domination of the global South and indigenous people. So, to call TEK religiously and culturally guided science or scientifically informed religious and cultural practice misses the point, in my opinion. It fails to take in the political and historical reasons for their separation and fails again to take into account why we are bringing these terms forward again in this time period. In my work, I focus largely on Haudenosaunee science and Henry Lickers, for example, and there are so many different ways to formulate traditional ecological knowledge and native science. The most prominent in Haudenosaunee tradition is naturalized science practice, which necessarily separates science from religion and separates indigenous knowledge from science. It's referred to as preferably distinct. And there are so many different ways to look at that. So when we look at traditional ecological knowledge as necessarily the same thing as religious practice, I think we're missing the point. Indigenous knowledge brings with it indigenous politics, indigenous genders and sexualities, indigenous kinship models and expression. It also brings histories of lived indigenous genocide and scientific termination. And these are all coded into traditional ecological knowledge production and all suffer similar erasure and violence as environments and non-humans. Indigenous knowledge offers an alternative and vocal other. It is not historically disconnected from other knowledges, but it boldly offers a reminder that these are but a few of the limitless potential formulations of knowing. So TEK should remind us not only that knowledge is political, but that ecology and religion are already inextricably intertwined at varying levels of explicitness and awareness. We do not need to ask how we might guide religious practice in order to better interact with the environment. Ecologies and religions are already performed by the same people, and they have been all along. Scholars of science and scholars of religion have common ground between them, and I often find that when I'm working at the Divinity School, I have much more in common than with pretty much anyone at Faculty of Arts and Sciences, because we're united by an understanding of a very large topic that we know is impossible to determine and to define. This focus, even as a heuristic tool, we understand that these ideas of science, these ideas of religion need to be continually unpacked and interrogated. And this focus on modes of knowing and relating not only with other humans, but with the divine, with the non-human, and the natural, and everything in between is invaluable. Why can't we apply that celebrated multiplicity to this problem? The enormity of the incoming and currently existing environmental crisis is daunting, but it is coming nevertheless, and it's not going to eliminate difference. If anything, without critique and without the ethics of witnessing, the coming environmental crisis will only widen the gap and highlight difference. And so I wonder if we were to take the relevance of religion not as a contention, but as a given reality, what new questions could we ask? Attention to the phenomenological and numinous makes religious practitioners and theorists particularly well suited to transition between global and local and the transcendent and the embodied. Instead of attempting to justify the moral authority of religion in juxtaposition to the epistemic authority of science, we could seriously investigate, reflect upon, and offer solidarity with the countless fractured experiences of that authority. If we want to push against what we perceive as a universalizing, progressive, and dangerous paradigm in the sciences, the best first step for us is to heed the particularities ourselves. However, I fear that we will continue to be blind to those particularities, the liminal and neglected spaces within there is so much potential if we don't pay more careful attention to the politics and dynamics of power. So in conclusion, and that's the end of my written talk, I feel like we could do much more if we moved away from internalist readings of religion and understood instead that we need to take into account histories and post-colonial politics and all these other multiple factors, because otherwise we won't be able to explain the difference between different nations. In my own tradition, there's a reason why, say, the Crow have adopted an expanding coal industry, whereas the Diné have essentially attempted to block every step toward expanded nuclear power. It's not because one has more indigenous knowledge than the other. It has to do with geographic histories and political histories and their own cultural history. And we cannot explain that simply by looking at traditional ecological knowledge as one sort of heuristic tool. Thank you.
Very interesting, Elias, the opening that Whitney brought us to where theory matters, and here we are on the ground in the midst of theory as it works itself out. I asked the panelists if they would take a moment. If they had a question that came to them as their other panel members were speaking. So I just want to open that possibility before we begin questions from the audience. Any observations from one another?
Whitney, I was interested if we could think a little bit more about your comment about nomads, just because there's such a history in traditional ecological knowledge, for example. There's such a history in traditional ecological knowledge, especially, again, Vine Deloria Jr., talking about how settlers are nomads, and this is part of the problem with the production of a science that we think is not okay. And so I'm kind of curious about how we can kind of draw the line between nomadicism and avoiding nationalism, and nomadicism and avoiding sort of an ethical responsibility to place.
Yeah. Are we going to answer questions?
Please,
now?
Go. Oh. Just a brief comeback if you care to.
Damn. So it's a very good question. I guess what I would say is that's the trick, right? That's the trick, and this is with this whole idea of a sort of developing a nomadic sort of planetary ethic is not just about it's not about I can fly all over the world and like experience all these things and I'm a nomad, but it's also about recognizing the global flows of information that go into your everyday life, whatever place you're in the global intersections of any given place. So there is no place that's cut off from any other, so on and so forth. It's an attempt, I think, again, to help sort of keep that balance between, Catherine talks about the plurisingular reality, but it's an attempt to keep that balance between the inextricable sort of relationality of all life and also the particularity. So, sure.
Within the panel, any other comments? And please don't hesitate later if you have a reflection on one another's work. So let's open it for questions. And Hava, I see your hand up. And then, please, Heather.
So my question is to you, Munjed, on basically suggesting to us a very fruitful, I guess, way to look at Islam, especially Islamic philosophy, Islamic mysticism, as ecological thinking. So I'm going to problematize it by my question. In Ibn Arabi and in every other Muslim thinker, including Nasser himself, what we have is a hierarchical thinking. There's just no other way to get out of hierarchy. So how does your paradigm help us deal with the egalitarianism that has been the dominant thread in our conversation in this conference?
That's an excellent question. Thank you for posing it. So there's definitely a hierarchy. And the issue that we have with hierarchy usually is the question, who's at the top then? And the top, and the person, and the one at the top of this hierarchy is God. That's the hierarchy here. Everything leads back to the divine principle. Everything manifests, radiates from the divine principle. And it's not a political maneuver to place a particular human being over others or something to that effect. But that's it. It's not anthropocentric. It is theocentric.
Suggesting that's only partially true because you do have all of those medieval thinkers think within a Neoplatonic ontology.
Yes.
And in the Neoplatonic ontology, you do have the one, then the soul, and then nature.
Yeah.
And there's just no way around that problem.
The soul includes nature's soul.
Fair enough. But
yes.
Also, when you get into what being really means, what God really means in Islamic philosophy, you go back to an Aristotelian paradigm of what is substance. You have a whole ontology that is so challenged today in the modern world. So when Nasser offers us to go back to a medieval paradigm, it comes with a huge question mark. And the fact that he hasn't been able to convince the scientific community to do what he wants to do should give us some pause. We need to think, why hasn't he been successful in convincing people to go to his sacred science? There's a reason for that.
So the degree to which or not, to which it's successful or not is I don't know. But what I can tell you about, I can talk to you about the content itself.
Democracy is fine, but it's a modern phenomenon. And order, or let's say peace, harmony. Harmony implies order. Order implies hierarchy. The questions of hierarchy, do you find hierarchy? Yeah, that's, no.
I think it's also helpful to remember that these are emergent voices rather than spokespeople for the whole field. Pardon me.
The question is, the problem with hierarchy is a dismissal of what is below, like of what is low on the hierarchy, and a glorification of what is above. Within this paradigm, what is above is the divine principle that everything relates to, everything connects to. What is below is the material that is appreciated for its connection to the divine principle. Everything is appreciated, and the criticism that it has of modern ways of thinking is that they do not appreciate everything. And it's saying that everything, including the materiality of the tree, including animals and all, are to be appreciated. There's a necessary appreciation over here. And it's never going to, Ibn Arabi is never going to put God on equal par with a human being. That's never going to happen.
Thanks for this really engaged beginning question and response. Heather.
So the first comment is, over the past 25 years in religion and ecology, there has been a constant expansion, diversification, plurality, different voices. So it's really, really delightful to hear all of you and where you sit and your theoretical and ethical orientations. But the emphasis I want to ask, or the question I have, is about this diversification. So the push against any kind of homogeneity, the push against any one narrative, I think that push is really, really important. My concern is, what do you see with, if the emphasis is polydoxy, multiplicity, plurality, if that's the actual basic emphasis, secondarily, ecological problems need to be solved across traditions, across science, they're going to require cooperation, joint ethics, joint orientations. So it's this one many in a simple way. Where do you all emerging scholars see this? Because you are now going to be this voice of plurality, differentiation, multiplicity. And I don't know if I'm just old school, but I'm really wondering about what is the basis of coherence and cooperation and joint ethics?
Okay, I'll start.
Why not?
Yeah, I know. Well, I think that those common grounds, so to speak, as Laurel and Catherine sort of might have identified, those common grounds emerge in the very process of rethinking both what nature is, what identities are, what religions are. So, for instance, I think that the comparative approach to these histories of religions breaks under the weight of globalized planetary identities, right? The truth is all religions have always already been mixed up, right? And we need different ways of talking about this. The truth is religion and science have always already been intertwined, and there is no separation. So we need different ways of sort of articulating this, and those different ways that we articulate these identities, these particular identities of hybridity and this sort of thing, then become the way in which we try to structure the world in a different way. So to go back to the title of the panel, it's emergent, right? I don't want to jump too quick to a telos or an end. I want this proliferation of ideas to continue.
Yeah, it's a great question. Thank you so much. I think that there may be, and I teach millennials a lot, and my observation and amazement with many of them is their ability to hold several things in tension at the same time in their mind, including intra-religious identities, which for most you know, basic entry into comparative religious thought is just kind of, that's dangerous. It can be considered very dangerous. I think that the reality is we are living in a time, and Willis's, there's one sentence in Willis's book that I just love, which it just opens wide this conversation about the fact that we're not in a position anymore to be able to hold down an old school perspective. The climate change is here. It's happening. There are communities that are drowning right now. So as a professor of religion, I actually can't go into my classroom and actually just teach one methodology. I really do want to present difference as a way of being and inclusiveness, I think, as a frame. Now, in different learning contexts, that's accepted or resisted. And I think as a woman of color teaching in a predominantly white college and university, that has a lot of layers to it. But what it has taught me a lot about is creating spaces for difference and uncomfortability. So I hope that that gets at some of it. It just seems to me that there we may be being called at this time to hold several things in tension. And that's going to require a different level of patience in the same way that ecocide is requiring us to grieve differently and lament differently. That we are moving in a new way. I think that that's important.
That really is an excellent question, and it's something I struggle with frequently. I think ultimately part of this comes down to method in terms of critique, right? The idea of critique is to continually break down, not necessarily with the idea of building something else back up, but as an ethic in and of itself, that is a useful political tool. And this also gets into queer theory and indigenous theory and post-colonial theory, where there is like this sort of sense of existing outside and the sense of negativity. And then, of course, the question becomes, then what do we do? One of the reasons toward the end of my talk that I focus on solidarity is I think that's probably the way forward, that accepting this multiplicity allows us to make new connections in ways we wouldn't be able to if we were looking for one master narrative. And ultimately, as Melanie said, the crisis is here and it's going to continue to come and we're going to suffer either way. And I think the idea now is really to focus on this ethics of witnessing and this sort of this solidarity and political attunement. Unfortunately, I don't think we're going to be able to create a narrative that will allow us to direct something in a certain way. Not that I'm saying that you're suggesting that necessarily, but
it's more how does differentiation allow us to move forward, not in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
That's the question.
Yeah, I'll just say this because we haven't talked a lot about ecofeminism during our time together, and there is something sacred about women coming to a table and figuring something out. And I think we've got to go back to those kind of sacred women's circles and that kind of wisdom, whether one identifies as female or not. Coming to that kind of communing and collaborative method, which is often born organically at the table. But I'm remembering, too, my heart opening when you asked the question yesterday about race, class, gender analysis. Like whether or not that's effective anymore. And I do think that even within feminist circles and certainly within womanist circles, we're looking at a whole new opportunity here to begin to shake that theoretical frame because it doesn't hold. It doesn't hold.
There are two questions. I can't resist.
I think that's an excellent question and brings to light.
A little closer to the mic. Yeah.
Yes, I think that's an excellent question. That we need a pluralism on both the level of discipline and also in our address of religions. Cooperation, also for discipline, much of what I've been saying is that a proper response to the ecological crisis is not just an environmental engineering, but you need the humanities too. And then also within the humanities, race theory can really contribute to our understanding of the environment, putting conversations, regarding the human plane, putting them into conversation with things regarding nature, and bringing to light that the humanity is only really a species in nature and is a part of it. It's all really very well connected. And then also for religion, I think Professors Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Grimm are really championing a great effort at putting religions in conversation with each other. Many times they've said that, for example, the Christian world can benefit a lot from looking to East Asian religions, for example, and vice versa.
I just wanted to throw one more thing out there that came up from your paper, Elias. And I'm not sure, many of you probably know Alonda Clay, and she's another person that is active in this field, but she has this one example, I think, is that, you know, to get over this way of thinking ecological knowledge, science, and traditional ecological knowledge. She said, no, it's all transcultural ecological knowledge. There is no knowledge of nature without these trans connections, these flows, right? So let's get rid of this whole sort of dichotomy altogether and think about it all as transcultural ecological knowledge. You know?
Forgive me the intervention. Elias, do you know Nadaski's work, Paul Nadaski, on hunters and bureaucrats? A very interesting take, isn't it, on this traditional environmental knowledge and who gets to say what is traditional environmental. Elizabeth and Cynthia and Chris, let's go that way, and Gregory, I'll be right up. Please.
Thanks for this really stimulating panel. You guys are awesome. I think this is mostly for Elias, but it really intersects with other people's talks too, so please feel free to jump in.
Elizabeth, can you put the microphone?
Yeah, I think, is it on? Yeah. Okay. So I think I heard you critiquing strategic essentialism in Vine Deloria. So my question. Yeah. Exactly. My question relates to that. So certainly there can be critiques of strategic essentialism, and also I think that it's, you know, important politically for a lot of liberation movements, and so it, like Vine Deloria, for example, sort of takes a moral high ground from that strategic essentialism to critique the dominant paradigm and the hegemony of it. And so if you were critiquing that strategic essentialism, then I'm wondering what other alternatives you're offering for liberation movements. And I think that applies generally.
Thank you. So I'm not really critiquing strategic essentialism, although, I mean, even Spivak has critiqued strategic essentialism. Everyone has. I think it's absolutely necessary, and I think it's part of a valid political toolbox. I think in my work, since I'm sort of trying to take a step back and view how this strategic essentialism came forward, I want to be able to break it down, but I don't think that it is not useful on the ground. I think it's absolutely necessary. I think that's why, in a lot of strange ways, global warming has hastened this sort of emerging global indigeneity movement, because it's allowed for cross nation movements that just simply wouldn't have existed before and provided new stages for such. And I think that's really useful. I've found a lot of really productive things coming out of that conversation. It's problematic, but that's not necessarily a bad thing, right? I mean, it's productive, and that's what we need.
Cynthia in the back.
Really appreciated the groundbreaking work that you've done in developing and articulating explicitly method in eco-womanist ethics. And I'm picking up from your work that eco-womanist method might have a lot to teach us about undoing the kind of separation between social transformation and personal healing, and the separations between social and environmental justice that pervade a lot of discourse and practice. Can you say something more about eco-womanist method that can help inform ongoing methodological development in religion and ecology?
Thank you. There's a 7-step method within eco-womanism, and the first step really opens up with story and honoring experience. And so this goes back to the conversation and the question that I asked the other day about eco-memory, because it's a first step of actually asking the question, what is our relationship to the earth, and when did that relationship begin? So what is your earth story, essentially? And for the many of us, that earth story begins way beyond our own being. It begins with our ancestors, it begins with spiritual ancestors, it begins sometimes with the heartbeat of the land, a tree. However we identify our own path and story, but from that understanding or that naming of one's eco story, then one can walk into the kind of reflecting on what that means. What does it mean to be the descendant of sharecroppers, right, and the descendant of African slaves in this particular continent, in these particular places? And then to, I'm the descendant of the Great Migration. My grandparents moved, like, with many millions of African Americans from the South to the West, beginning to have a conversation and a life in the Rocky Mountains. So that opens up just that second step of reflecting on experience. That opens up the question, not only about what is the agricultural memory that my grandparents would have had in the South, and whether or not does that translate to the Rocky Mountains of Colorado? Not necessarily. So how did they survive? So there, that opens up to the third step of actually asking different analytical questions. And here's where the framing of race, class, gender, environmental injustice kind of helps to begin to open up the conversation. The fourth step is really being critical of our religious traditions, particularly when they keep us in silos. The fifth step begins to help us to engage transformation. And this is the point where one has to be particularly attentive and intentional, because a transformation can be explosive. And then, so being mindful, I think, is really helpful in this step. And the sixth and seventh step really begin to engage dialogue. So this is where interreligious dialogue, comparative religious frames are essential. Being in conversation, for example, with someone like Alice Walker, who identifies as triracial, which is part African-American, part white and Cherokee native. So what does it mean to have that kind of cosmology all in conversation with each other? So that sixth step really looks at dialogue. And then the seventh step is to engage and act for justice.
That's very special. Thank you. I'm going to come back, Frederick. Chris, and then Gregory. Great.
Thanks. I just want to thank all of you for amazing intellectual inspiration and getting our brains and hearts thinking together. So this is something I've been wrestling with a lot, and if the question is not entirely clear, I apologize, because in my head it's still not entirely clear. But it seems to me that in the last 10 or 15 years, we've been seeing environmental justice movements and social justice movements increasingly not only collaborating, but maybe even merging into some new hybrid movement that we don't have a language for yet. I think you see some of it in climate justice, but I still think it doesn't fully capture it. And I think a big chunk of that has been the rise of indigenous rights movements, the ability to use things like UNDRIP, the ILO 169, and other such legal tools as part of indigenous political struggles. But yet in our conversations today, it seems much easier, or this whole weekend, to talk about Standing Rock and solidarity there, but not Black Lives Matter, not solidarity with the Muslim community that's being targeted and profiled, with Central and South American migrants who are being demonized through the political rhetoric. And so my question for all of you is, do you think that it is easier for the religion and ecology sort of circle of people to move to support indigenous political movements within the broader context of social movements, but not other issues? And if so, why? Or if not, how do you see that constellation of social movements and religion and ecology overlapping? Thanks.
That is a very good question. I think the collaboration between environmentalism and indigenous movements is very, very old, since pretty much the birth of environmentalism. And thankfully, finally, in the last couple decades, it's being indigenous run, because it was not always. I mean, Ironized Cody is a great example, right? But I think it is easier in a lot of ways, just due to the nature of indigenous rights movements and the sort of the political and legal mechanisms that have been best in reinforcing sovereignty and reinforcing social justice movements on indigenous lands. I think it's a problem. I think we need to, and there's always been an issue of sort of creating that environmentalist ethic within other social justice movements. And I think you're right. It's something that we need to start critiquing and start thinking about. And it's something I'm trying to work on in my own work, but it's difficult. Every time that I sort of go through and put forward a new formulation of what I'm working on, I'm constantly reminded I need to go back and think about African American experiences with Western scientific hegemony and all these other experiences that shape it and are less obvious due to different colonial histories. And we need to take that seriously and not value that sort of master narrative that places these other movements within a much more nationalist and much more social issue frame.
Environmental justice, including all across the spectrum. So I don't think that it's been ignored. It needs to be totally raised up.
Yeah, but reference this weekend. Gregory, we are running out of time, so I'm going to ask if you can make your... Go right to your remarks rather than extend it. And that may leave time, Frederick, also.
Okay, so my question really relates to... issues of valuation. So I think this project that both Evelyn and John, you've put together is a attempt to normalize evaluations across religious paradigms. I think that might be a reasonable analysis. I mean, it's much broader than that, clearly, but it might approach this in one way. So my question to all of you is valuation of knowledge and valuation of religious activity as it relates to valuation of science and scientific activity under the current, in the current paradigms. What are your thoughts? Where do you see these, what is the possible mechanism by which valuations would be more equitable, which will allow different disciplines to be more able to speak to each other? I think there's a fundamental problem in just how people value different things, the weight of science or the weight of religion or the weight of law or the weight of business, weight of indigenous knowledge, the weight of indigenous science. So that's my question.
I mean, I think just really shortly, I think that answer is probably different for everybody up here and everybody in this room. Yeah, so I don't know. You know, I think it's very much. I mean, for me, my own, I'm more of a religious naturalist than anything. If I had to cast my lot somewhere, but then again, I'm not sort of reductive in my understanding of science. So, and where does that, you know, so. I mean, I just think it's such a personalized question that it's hard to provide more of a overview answer in terms of what should be done. But definitely, in systems that are privileging certain subjects over the other, which we all know which subjects I'm talking about, you know, and in which sciences are the privileged form of discourse, then I think it's very important to lift up. In special ways, all these other voices that are underprivileged. So, yeah.
Frederick, there's time for a short comment.
Yes, I just wanted to say that first of all, to congratulate you. This is a wonderful panel. Great, great presentation. Great work. That there are many sacred sciences. And what we have today is the equivalent in the field of knowledge of the catastrophic decrease in diversity, biodiversity in the plant world. So we have the same phenomenon in the field of knowledge and language, species, everything. And the dominant form of classical Western science was very much tied to a particular group of male, upper class, usually aristocratic European males. And there is enough now deconstruction of the history to show that the universality was a continuum from the religious discourse, even though they wanted to divorce totally from religious discourse. So I think that diversity exists. Mm-hmm. It's under threat, terribly. And whether you think to foster this diversity, I think we need a gnosis diversity. You know?
like biodiversity, something like that.
Thank you, Frederick. Yeah. Last comments, please, from all of you.
Thank you so much. I do want to be clear as possible, around eco-womanist frame, to recognize the importance of biodiversity and the importance of diversity as it is reflected beautifully in the earth. Somehow racism doesn't always impact the tree, unless the tree is complicit in an act of lynching. What's the responsibility of the tree? And as Alice Walker will write and Larry Rasmussen will quote, when you cut a tree, does your own arm bleed? So I think this is a radical vision, an eco-womanist vision from my perspective, but I think it goes way beyond eco-womanism. It's a radical envision of biodiversity. And yet, embodied in this particular aspect of the beauty of the earth, in this particular social location at this particular moment, as an African-American woman, I do ask the field, what are we doing about the devaluing of particular earthlings that we keep seeing happen again and again? That voice, that question, it has to be answered.
I think that's an excellent point and question. All these epistemologies really constitute different repositories of knowledge. And I think that there is a parallel. There's some kind of reflection between a threat to biodiversity and a threat to epistemological diversity. And the field of Islam and ecology, as I've received it, as I've inherited it, says as much, and says that rather it says that the roots of a threat to biodiversity is actually a threat to epistemological diversity. In limiting the ways in which nature can be perceived, we treat nature in this very particular way.
Thank you. It's appropriate remark from Chris Chappell at this point before we end the panel, just briefly.
I want to thank Whitney and Melanie for being guest editors of Worldviews. Worldviews, Global Religions, Culture, and Ecology is a Brill imprint. It advances the good work that we all do. Many of you have published there. And I encourage you, when we invite you to read something, please read it quickly. I want to introduce Abby Britton, if you could raise your hand. She's our new editorial assistant. And we will talk again briefly at the forum luncheon next month. But I just want to applaud the vision of our guest editors, including Heather right here, and others who have wanted to move an idea forward fairly quickly. And just thank all of you who continue to write. Encourage your libraries to subscribe. And I have a little piece of good news that I'm going to gloat just slightly. But I just happened to, a couple of years ago, been in a context where I was nervous because, you know, people don't buy print subscriptions anymore. And the list looked rather meager. But I came to find out that it's all about the downloads. And that our number of downloads per year are actually greater than the Journal of the American Academy of Religion. So, so please put that little link to your favorite article in your syllabus, on your Brightspace or your Blackboard or whatever it may be, because our voice is very important. Thank you.
And it's in that spirit of leadership that I want to ask your applause for these leaders into the future.